Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Benefits of Being an Octopus by Ann Braden. Narrated by Amy Melissa Bentley. The history of the octopus illustrates the brain's ability to evolve. As they lost their ancestors' protective shells, they were forced to become more intelligent. The Octopus, Graceful Cephalopod of the Deep, by Derby King. Chapter 1. I settle onto the couch with the chocolate pudding I saved from Friday's school lunch. This silence is amazing. Well, it's not complete silence. Hector is spinning the whirring dragon on his baby seat while he eats Cheerios. But it's pretty close. I savor a spoonful of pudding. How long do I have before Bryce and Aurora burst out of our bedroom arguing about something? When I left them in there, Aurora was pretending to be Bryce's cat, and he was pretending to feed her milk. But that can't last. I mean, they're 4 and 3. That's not how it works. I take another bite with my eye on the bedroom door, but it stays closed. This never happens. I glance down at my backpack. My debate prep packet is inside, and I'm actually tempted to work on it. I'm not a kid who does homework, and I definitely don't do big projects, which usually require glitter and markers and poster board and all sorts of things, none of which I have. Plus, last year in 6th grade, when I actually turned in a poster project, Kaylee Vine announced to the whole class, "Everyone, alert the authorities. Zoey Albro turned in a project. The world must be ending." Then she made that sound like the fire drill, and did it every time she passed me in the hall for the whole next week. But this project doesn't need any glitter, and everyone else won't have fancy poster boards with foam letters that make my flimsy piece of newsprint that the teachers gave me look like gray toilet paper. All I need is to know something. And I do. And maybe, just maybe, if I do this, and if I can rock it, all the other kids will have their minds blown, and it'll be completely satisfying to watch. "Who would have guessed," they'll say, "that Zoey knew so much cool stuff? I had no idea. I thought I knew who she was, but clearly I didn't, at all." Maybe Kaylee Vine would even stop holding her nose and switching seats on the bus to get away from me. I take out the debate prep packet and lean over the coffee table. "Which animal is the best? Support your selection with as many details as possible, including what it takes to survive in a variety of situations." Ms. Rochambeau, the social studies teacher, says this debate will help us understand the debates that led up to the Civil War. And Mr. Peck, the science teacher, says it'll be a good assessment of all the work we've been doing about animals. And the thing is, I already know which animal is best, the octopus. When Bryce was a tantruming toddler and Aurora was a baby, we moved 4 times over the course of that year. But the one constant was this little TV/DVD combo that we toted around with us, and an old DVD from the library free shelf. The mysterious and fascinating world of the octopus. That DVD would send Bryce into an instant trance, and we watched it so often that I happily memorized every word of it. Then, last year, When I couldn't go on the sixth grade field trip to the aquarium in Boston, my mom kept forgetting to send in the payment. Ms. Giddings, the guidance counselor, brought me back a book on octopuses. And actually, octopuses is correct. You don't have to say octopi if you don't want to. The book told me so. I find a pencil nub at the bottom of my backpack and start filling in the blanks with awesome things. Like their ability to instantly camouflage themselves, which they're amazing at because they have these things called chromatophores. That word was in my book. So the color of their skin can change to match what's around them. They even have muscles that can change their skin's texture. Of course, it means that when they get mad or nervous, they turn red and pimply. But nothing's perfect, right? Ms. Rochambeau will be as surprised as anyone else when I stand up for the debate and use a word like chromatophore. I settle deeper into the couch. If this were a regular Sunday, or really any day, Frank would be here watching TV, usually angry news guys. Frank is Lenny's dad, and Lenny is the owner of this trailer. Lenny is also my mom's boyfriend, and that's why we get to live here with his nice curtains and end tables that are perfectly aligned with his couch. Lenny even has an alphabetized DVD collection. He also has a recliner that Frank sits in like he's glued to it. But today, Frank went out for a walk to check on the tree damage from a recent ice storm. And since Lenny and my mom are both at work, Hector and I get the main room of the trailer to ourselves. So even though Ms. Rochambeau announced that we needed our completed packet to be part of the debate, this time, I can actually do it. This time, I don't have to be counted out. I'm 3 pages into the 4-page packet when Hector starts throwing the Cheerios all over Lenny's nice carpet. I get down on the floor so I can pick them up. "Those are for eating, not for throwing," I tell him. But he keeps throwing them anyway. I remove his ammunition. So naturally, he starts screaming. Then, since Hector's scream seems to work like the bat signal, Bryce and Aurora burst out of our bedroom door, trampling all the Cheerios in their path. Bryce is yelling about his imaginary bucket of doom. Aurora climbs into my lap and covers her ears. If I were an octopus, things would be so much easier. I'd have one arm to wipe Aurora's nose, 2 more for holding both kids' hands when I pick them up from the Head Start bus stop to keep Bryce from wandering into the street after some rock he's spotted. 1 to hold Hector and his diaper bag on the afternoons when my mom works at the pizza pit. 1 to adjust my shirt because it doesn't really fit, and it can get too revealing if I'm not paying attention, and I don't want to be that girl. 1 so I could do my homework at least some of the time if I wanted. 1 to pick up the Cheerios that are always on the floor. And the last 1 to swipe a can of Easy Cheese from the Cumberland Farms convenience store. Because little snowmen out of Easy Cheese are the most magical thing little kids have ever seen. And Easy Cheese letters on a saltine is totally different than having to eat regular saltines. Aurora knew the letter A before she even turned 2, thanks to Easy Cheese letters. The main door opens, and I hear Lenny stamping the snow off his boots in the hallway. I drop my debate packet into my backpack and get the rest of the Cheerio dust scraped into my hand as fast as I can.
"How's my baby?"
Lenny booms as he comes around the corner into the main room. He pats Hector on the head and then heads to the fridge to get a soda. Lenny is Hector's dad. He's not Bryce and Aurora's dad. That was Nate. Nate used to take me hunting, which was cool. No meat tastes as good as the stuff you've caught yourself. But Nate's not around anymore. And my own dad was gone long before I could throw Cheerios. My mom doesn't seem to think he's worth talking about too much, but you never know. Maybe he secretly liked documentaries as much as I do. It's all okay, though, because I like football, too, and so does Lenny. Plus, tonight is a playoff game, and when my mom gets home from her shift, she's going to make her bacon-wrapped hot dog bites. Those are what got us Lenny in the first place. Maybe they'll make up for all the other stuff. That evening, my job is to keep Bryce and Aurora in our bedroom so they don't grab the bacon-wrapped hot dog bites before they're cooked. With Hector balanced on my hip, I position myself as a human shield near the door while simultaneously keeping my eye on Lenny's nice lamp, ready to leap for it if necessary. Hector sucks hard on his pacifier as he watches Bryce and Aurora launch their plastic battle bots into the blanket volcano. But then Bryce picks up Aurora's precious stuffed sea turtle, Petunia, as the next sacrifice, and Aurora starts shrieking at the top of her lungs to stop him. That's one benefit of living in a town like this. When the rich people donate their old stuffed animals, you can end up with an awesome sea turtle that even has a fact printed on the tag about the dangers of shrimp nets. And anyway, we're not as poor as we used to be. We're living in Lenny's trailer now. I mean, it's a really nice lamp. I hear the clang of a spoon against the bowl as my mom mixes the barbecue sauce, the second to last step before the bites go in the oven. That means just a few more minutes before we can leave this room, and I can settle onto the couch like a boss to watch the game. Unfortunately, I'm not the only one who can hear that spoon against the bowl. Both Bryce and Aurora have suddenly forgotten all about the volcano.
"Bacon, bacon wap!"
Aurora shrieks. Bryce makes a break for the door. Instantly, I'm in full-on barricade mode. "You're not eating one until they're cooked, just like everyone else." I don't need to remind them what happened the last time my mom made these. The barbecue sauce stain on Lenny's wallpaper doesn't let anyone forget. Bryce is trying to push me out of the way using every bit of his scrawny 4-year-old arms, but I am immovable. Plus, Hector is helping to weigh me down.
"No fair, Zoey,"
Aurora wails.
"What if they're all gone?"
"There'll be one for each of you when they're ready." Aurora puts on her sour eyes face.
"I don't believe you."
"Trust me. Both of you will get a bacon-wrapped hot dog bite." I pry Bryce's hands off of my sweatshirt, but he keeps pushing on me with his head like a silent slow-motion ram.
"I promise."
Bryce stops his ramming and looks up.
"Pinky promise."
I nod and hook my pinky around his. "Pinky promise." It's only when I hear the oven door closing shut and the beeps of my mom setting the timer on the stove that I release them.
"Remember,"
I whisper, pulling them close before they can zoom by me.
"No yelling, no running, no messes."
Magically, they settle right down on the far side of the living area and start playing quietly with their toy cars. The promise of a bacon-wrapped hot dog bite is a powerful thing. Frank is back in his recliner. The pregame show is on, but even though we've lived with him and Lenny for a whole year and a half, I don't know if he even likes football. I don't know if he actually likes anything. He's like a beetle propped belly up,
especially if that beetle is the kind that spends most of the time with either a cigarette stuck in its mouth or a strand of cinnamon-flavored floss hanging from its teeth. One's healthier than the other, but both are gross. I sidle up to my mom in the kitchen area, but she doesn't thank me for my heroic feat of keeping the kids out from underfoot. She just takes Hector from me. "He needs a bath," she says. I hear Lenny in the entryway, coming in from outside. He went out to check on his car an hour ago, and I bet he ended up talking to everyone in the trailer park. Everyone knows Lenny, and everyone loves Lenny. He strides across the living area into the kitchen, the frigid January air still clinging to him.
"How's my pair of cuties?"
he says to my mom and Hector. His voice is loud enough for him to be still talking to the neighbors. He takes Hector from her and bends down with him so they can peer into the oven window.
"And look what's in there. You see how she wrapped up each hot dog bite real tight, Hector? That'll make sure each bite begins and ends with bacon. And they're going to come out nice and crispy because your mommy knows how to take them out at the exact right time to add the extra barbecue sauce."
My mom stops drying her hands to give a little laugh and a curtsy. Maybe making these will remind Lenny why he got together with her in the first place. She used to tell great jokes, too, ones that would have Lenny doubled over laughing at her impressions. But it's been a long time since she told one. Once the coin toss starts the game, Lenny gives Hector back to my mom and settles on the couch with his soda. He never drinks beer. And the giant tub of cheese puffs he gets from Walmart just for football games. I sit down next to him, and he hands me the cheese puffs without a word. I like that, how it's just understood that I get to hold them. My mom disappears with Hector into the bathroom for his bath, but that's okay. Patriots games are my time with Lenny anyway. Not only do I get to hold the cheese puffs, but if there's some football rule I don't get, like knowing where the defender's hands can't be when a receiver is trying to catch the ball, then Lenny explains it. Both of us are always on the edge of the couch for every third down, me eating those cheese puffs and him drinking his soda. Basically, it's the best time ever. By the time the game gets underway, Bryce and Aurora have shifted to right in front of the TV, but they still only pay attention for commercials when it's more fun. Mostly, they're zooming the toy cars around, pretending they're trying to outrace the Death Star. They haven't seen the movie yet, so they don't exactly get it.
"Come on, defense,"
Lenny mutters.
"You got this."
"Let's get a sack right here," I say, leaning forward. Lenny nods and takes a swig of soda without taking his eyes off the screen.
"That's right. Push him out of field goal range. Listen to Zoey."
We watch as the Colts hike the ball and our defensive linemen close in on the quarterback. The pocket's closing around him, and then, ooh, even better, it's a fumble.
"Yes!"
Lenny yells, pumping his fist in the air as the refs unpack the pile of players and signal the Patriots now have possession. Lenny and I high-five, and then I lick the orange cheese dust off my fingers in celebration. This is how things are supposed to be. I've got a nice couch to sit on, which, thanks to Lenny, is perfectly centered in the room. Cheese puffs to eat, and a great game to watch. At halftime, when no one's looking, I reach into my backpack for my debate packet and slip it into my front hoodie pocket. I'll finish it after the game. But when I look up, I realized that when I wasn't paying attention, Bryce and Aurora got so excited about a commercial that they started hurling toy cars at the TV. Before I can stop them, Frank erupts from the depths of his recliner.
"Throw one more stupid car at my TV, and I'll pound you into the ground!"
He keeps shouting, and it's like watching an ancient, wrinkled mountain explode, revealing an interior that's straight up, burning, swear-filled lava. Bryce and Aurora scream and run into our bedroom, tripping over each other as they go. They slam the door shut, and I hate myself, because in the far back corner of my mind, a horrible part of me is glad that I can watch the rest of the game in peace. That's when the power goes out. Of course it does. Next to me, Lenny stands up and immediately trips over the coffee table. My mom bursts in from the bathroom, using her phone as a flashlight and carrying a soaking wet Hector on her hip. Lenny calls over to her.
"You got any guesses why we're in the dark?"
But she doesn't say anything. She just heads for the oven and takes out the bacon-wrapped hot dog bites. "I'm sorry. Hopefully they'll still be crispy." She props the phone / flashlight under her chin, hefts Hector up higher on her hip, and transfers the hot dog bites onto a plate with a spatula. They smell amazing. Like the pig is roasting on a spit right in the living room, dripping delicious grease all over the carpet. Lenny makes his way into the kitchen as my mom pours the rest of the barbecue sauce over the top of them. He pops one in his mouth and then shakes his head.
"I've had better."
I'm sorry, my mom stammers. "And I'm sorry you can't watch the rest of the game." Lenny takes the plate of hot dog bites and shrugs.
"I'll watch it at Sliders."
And with that, Lenny and the plate are out the door, and I'm left sitting on the couch. No Lenny, no game, no bacon-wrapped hot dog bites. And I'd promised. Chapter 2. Frank starts that old man snore of his, because he always goes to sleep the instant the TV goes off. In the kitchen, my mom works to scrape the burned bits of bacon off the baking sheet.
"Zoey, can you go check on Bryce and Aurora?"
Oh, look. She hasn't forgotten that I exist. "Shouldn't someone go check the fuse box or something?" I say.
"I'm sure it's out everywhere. Go check on your brother and sister."
I push myself up off the couch and wind my way through the dark to the window. Pulling back Lenny's nice curtains makes it pretty clear that the rest of the trailer park is lit up all bright and showy. "It's just us," I say.
"Zoey Albro, I asked you to go check on them. Lenny's pans are going to be impossible to get clean later if I let this stuff harden."
Why are clean pans more important than a functioning fuse box? It's been a long time since my mom made any sense. At least the light from the other trailers makes it easier to walk across the rest of the living area. When I push open the door to our bedroom, it's pitch black, and nothing seems to be moving. "Bryce? Aurora?" All I hear in response is a whimper coming from their bed. I quickly make my way through the dark, stepping on battle bots and other little plastic toy parts as I go. I hear the whimper again. "Bryce?" I put my hand out toward the sound and find him. He's trembling. I hear a muffled sob and feel Aurora laying next to him. She's shaking too.
We
Bryce starts, but his words disappear into a hiccup. Are you guys okay? Another hiccup, more whimpering. What's wrong? I say.
We can't see.
Bryce finally sobs.
We can't see anymore.
I let out a long breath. They're not hurt. They're not sick.
Is it because we got Frank mad at us?
I squeeze each of their hands. Oh, you sillies. It's just that the power is out. Your eyes still work fine. I crawl across the bed to get to the window and pull the curtains to the side. See? You can see the icicles coming off of the neighbor's roof, right? In the glow from the neighbor's motion sensor porch light, I can make out their faces. Bryce is biting his lip, but it keeps quivering anyway. Aurora has Petunia the sea turtle in a death grip and is sucking on one of her flippers. Their eyes are still fixed in a state of terror. My mom and I have gone through the power going off plenty of times, but Bryce and Aurora were too little to remember. What are they supposed to think when all the lights go out? When suddenly there's no Mickey Mouse nightlight and no warning. Bryce turns toward Aurora and wraps his arm around her, his nose buried in her hair.
At least we got hot dog bites.
I try to swallow, but it catches in my throat. Aurora sniffs and looks at me.
You gonna tell us when they ready?
Her eyes. Why do her eyes have to be so hopeful? Guys, I'm so sorry. There aren't any hot dog bites for us. Aurora lets out a wail. Bryce shuts his eyes, curls into a ball, and covers his ears with his hands.
No, 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 no!
I slide in next to them so I can wrap them both up tight. They both instantly burrow into me, Aurora at my shoulder and Bryce's head driving into my stomach. I'll tell you a story instead, okay? I say. I never knew I could tell stories, or Tories, as Aurora says, until one day when Bryce had woken up from one of his nightmares and couldn't get back to sleep no matter how much I rubbed his back. I had made up stories all the time before that to get myself out of trouble, like having to explain to my mom how I ended up with a new can of Easy Cheese from Cumberland Farms. But bedtime stories? Not so much. Thankfully, Bryce and Aurora don't exactly care, or know, that I'm just making it up as I go along. And telling stories means I get to spend time in a world where the person in charge of what happens is me. Tonight, I start with three kids who live in a castle and don't have electricity, and I go from there. And who cares if I take some parts from the Batman movie and some parts from a documentary I once watched about Genghis Khan? The main thing is that the kids triumph over evil, and that Bryce and Aurora both fall asleep. After they're both breathing evenly, I stay where I am, lying between them, staring out at those icicles. They're like teeth waiting to chomp someone. Because the problem is that real life isn't like a story. I'm not in charge, and it's usually the good guys who get chomped. But if I were an octopus, those icicles wouldn't get me. I would squish my body into a ball and jet away, fully camouflaged, of course. I slither out from Aurora's arms, find a pencil on the floor, and take the debate packet out of my pocket. I only have one page left, and I position myself at the window so I can use the neighbor's porch light. I go back and forth about whether it's a good thing that a baby octopus starts out life the size of a pencil eraser, because the eraser on my pencil is pretty darn small. But I decide to include it, because anything that can start out floating around defenseless in the ocean that size, and then defeat the odds to grow into this powerful creature, has to mean business. I fill out those remaining blanks. Every single one. Just as I finish, the front door slams, and I hear Lenny's voice. There's some fumbling around and a thump, like Lenny might have just smashed his toes on something. He curses.
"I'm so sorry," I hear my mom stammer.
"Well, it sure isn't my fault we're in this mess," Lenny snaps.
I can totally believe it's my mom's fault. Recently, it's like she can't do anything right.
"I thought I filled out the form right. I thought for sure we'd get approved for assistance," my mom starts.
Lenny interrupts her before she can say anything more.
"In there."
I don't know what he's talking about until I hear their bedroom door shut and I realize they've disappeared inside it. They almost never argue about money or bills or anything really when I can overhear them. The neighbor's light goes out, and I'm back to being completely in the dark. In so many ways. So, it wasn't the fuse box. It was the power company who cut us off. In our old life, Mom got really good at filling out the form for financial assistance to take care of it. But she hasn't exactly been a take care of it mom for a while now. And she sure isn't the one left holding Aurora and Bryce when everything falls to pieces. I take a deep breath. An octopus might start out defenseless, but it sure doesn't stay that way. On a wave of octopus arms, I roll across our bedroom, sliding around the battle bots, checking the distance to my mattress so I don't trip over it, and simultaneously reaching for the doorknob with one of my tentacles. I silently roll across the main room, my skin changing to match snoring Frank and his recliner as I pass by. Just around the corner, in the entryway, the washing machine sits up against the wall. It's broken, except for when it pretends to work and turns all of our clothes gray. But that doesn't matter now. I scale it, one sucker at a time, until I'm on top of it, right next to the section of wall that got all soft from a leak a while back. Right where Bryce's lightsaber made a hole last summer when he and Lenny were play fighting. It's a hole that leads right into my mom and Lenny's bedroom. And my hunch was right. I can hear what they're saying from here. If I put my eye up against the hole, I can even see them. Because that's the thing about an octopus. It knows it needs to hide its soft, squishy body out of sight. But if anyone bothered to take a closer look at the hole in the reef, they'd see a big, unblinking octopus eye staring out at them. Through the hole, I can see Hector sitting in the middle of the bed, waving my mom's phone/flashlight around like a strobe light. Lenny is organizing his undershirt drawer with an actual flashlight, completely oblivious to the disco dance party room that he's in. That's another thing about getting to live with Lenny in this trailer. It is seriously neat and tidy and organized. In our last apartment, pre-Lenny, the countertop was rotting around the edges, so you'd realize halfway through washing dishes that water had been pooling downstream into the carpeting. We basically spent our 6 months in that apartment, ducking under the 5 clotheslines that crisscrossed the main room and smelling like we lived in a swamp. Lenny's trailer, on the other hand, is the opposite of a swamp. His bathroom is the most non-moldy thing you've ever seen.
I told you I delivered that form last week, he's saying. You believe me, don't you?
My mom, sitting near Hector on the bed, dodges to the left to avoid being whacked by her strobe light phone.
Of course I believe you.
Lenny starts laying his undershirts out on the bed to refold them.
You can't always blame someone else.
My mom bites her lip and looks away.
It's just that I spent a whole day on that form. I thought I filled it out right.
But how would you even know if it's right?
I want to look away. She didn't used to be this much of a mess. But I force myself to keep my octopus eye pressed against the hole, wide and unblinking. Why is she the one that all four of us kids are related to? Why can't it be Lenny instead? All confident and competent. No one at school would mess with me if I were like him.
I know, my mom stammers. But I asked Connor to look at it first, and he thought it...
My mom's voice falters. In the disco light, I can make out Lenny shaking his head.
Really? Really?
He stops folding and crosses the room to be right next to my mom.
You really showed all the private details about our lives to Connor?
Connor waits tables at the pizza pit, too, and he's basically the only friend my mom has right now. He's also totally awesome, but Lenny never seems to be a big fan of his. I don't know if it's because Connor's gay or if it's because of something else. Hector drops my mom's phone and starts crying.
I thought he could help, my mom says quickly. He's not someone who would judge us or anything, and he doesn't get all flustered with forms like that, and...
Lenny hands my mom's phone back to Hector, and then wraps his arms around my mom from behind. I remember him wrapping her up like this when they first got together, and how she would close her eyes and lean her head against his shoulder, like there was nowhere else to be in the world.
We can take care of our own business ourselves, Lenny says. You've got me taking care of you now.
My mom has her eyes squeezed shut, but it's not like before when she'd be looking all calm. It's more like how Bryce looked when he accidentally crashed into Lenny's tower of alphabetized DVDs, and he closed his eyes tight, as if that'd make the mess he'd made go away. I scoot down off the washing machine. I can't stand to see my mom's face looking like that. If she could do stuff right the first time around, it wouldn't have to be like this. Chapter 3. In the morning, I wake up to the sound of Lenny's car pulling out of the driveway. The electricity still isn't back on, but the sun, that rebel, has started to lighten the sky for free. Another thing about Lenny is that he's never late to work. Even though his part-time job at the auto parts store has him leaving before 7, he's still on time. On time and as clean-shaven as you could possibly get. Between Lenny's obsession with his lather shaving brush and his insistence on paying attention to the little details like clocks and his car's odometer, he's basically the exact opposite of my mom's other boyfriends, with their varying degrees of scruffiness and whose main talents were eating all the food in our fridge. Well, Bryce and Aurora's dad, Nate, wasn't bad. He was kind, and those times he took me hunting were super fun. But then he stopped hunting and started drinking, and you can't hold down a job and take care of kids when you're like that. He'd just look out the window of the camper van we lived in back then, like the answer was out there. I mean, maybe it was, because my mom told him loads of times to go to AA meetings, but he never went. Things went south between him and my mom one day when we were at the boat launch. He had been trying to convince Bryce to go swimming with him, but Bryce couldn't swim, and Nate was drunk and didn't exactly remember that. Evidently, being yelled at by your girlfriend in front of your kids and a whole bunch of kayakers wakes up something inside you, and he drove off in the camper van and didn't come back. I push myself up on the mattress until I can see Bryce and Aurora. Bryce had one of his nightmares last night, but you wouldn't know it from looking at him now. They're both still breathing deep, like two little squirrely-haired Darth Vaders. I hate waking them up. It's like you finally won the lottery of peace and quiet, and then you rip that winning ticket to shreds and dump a bucket of angry, screaming monkeys on your head. I pull on my own clothes and brush my hair, and then perch myself next to them on their bed and give them each a little nudge. Bryce, Aurora, time to get up. Just a few years ago, my mom was the one waking me up. She'd sing this little good morning song, even though she can't carry a tune. That was when she had to keep a bag of frozen corn on her face to numb the pain from rotting teeth. Because some people have parents who remind them to brush their teeth, but my mom's didn't. Still, she was determined not to take...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.